Guys, so today I'm here with Financial Current Affair. Do watch my videos for regular updates on Financial Current Affair and subscribe to our channel. Click on the bell icon. So today we'll be discussing about the topic of unregulated deposits. So as we all know that this is the hot topic in today's newspaper that on July 29, 2019 has passed the bill for ban on the unregulated deposits. So the current affair, the MCQ today is, Parliament clears the bill to ban unregulated deposits, which seeks to protect the interest of the depositors. Which of the following activity is not included in the ambit of this bill? First is chit funds. Second is a builder taking loans against promissory note for repayment after the tenures of 3 to 6 or 12 months. C part is deposit schemes with builders and jewelers that work like advances against the purchase of goods at a later date. D part is where a deposit taker takes a loan from his friends or relatives. So, to answer this question, we'll first study the concept of unregulated deposits. So, in this document, we shall be studying that what unregulated deposits are, the concept and the provisions which have been introduced. Let's start with the unregulated deposits. The word suggests unregulated. So this includes the deposits accepted by the deposit taker which are not regulated by any authority. So unregulated deposits are not regulated by any authority. Unlike the regulated deposits which are regulated by some or the other authority. So there are various regulators overseeing the deposit taking schemes in India. First is RBI. RBI oversees the deposits taken by NBFC. Then Securities and Exchange Board of India, which oversees the mutual funds. Then we have Ministry of Corporate Affairs. As we all know, they regulate the companies. State governments oversees the chit funds. So these are all the regulators which oversees the deposit taking schemes. Now, what are the types of unregulated deposits? So first is the Ponzi scheme and the other are chit fund schemes. So Ponzi schemes are the schemes, they are the type of investment fraud wherein one party promises high returns on an investment. So the early investors in a Ponzi scheme are repaid by the scheme, acquiring new investors and so on. So once there are no longer enough people to secure a new round of investments, the scheme collapses and the investors lose their money. So let me explain it with the help of example. So suppose there is A who is a deposit taker. He takes the deposits from B and A promises to repay B after 3 months. So after 3 months, when the time comes to repay B, A again takes loan from C, suppose, then A will use the deposits given by C to repay B. So the mechanism is that for repaying earlier investor, new loan has been taken to repay the earlier investor. So this is known as Ponzi scheme, and once no such new investors are available, this Ponzi scheme collapses and the investors like B, which are the earlier investors who will not get their money repaid, they will suffer. So the news is that there is a ban on the unregulated deposits because of this kind of Ponzi scheme, because these Ponzi schemes affect small investors. So we'll discuss it in a while in detail. Now, chit fund schemes are regulated by state governments, but there are two types of chit fund schemes. First is regulated and the other is unregulated. So the regulated ones are the one which are regulated by state governments, and the unregulated chit fund schemes are under the unregulated deposits. Now, what is out of the ambit? Now, what does it mean? So there is a ban on unregulated deposits, but not all kind of unregulated deposits are banned. Only the ones which have the nature, which takes the nature of the Ponzi scheme, which I just described here, are banned. So there are few exceptions or exemptions, we can say, for this act. So first is loans from relatives. So if you take loans from relatives or from friends to finance your needs or for any other personal purpose. So this is not included in this act. That is, these all are valid. These are all legal. Only Ponzi schemes and unregulated chit funds are illegal, which have been banned. Now, second is credit given to a buyer or a seller of a real estate in a property transaction. Note that a credit given to a seller of real estate for the property transaction, for the term of business, this credit has been given. So we'll discuss this in detail in the next section. Then we have periodic payments by the members of self-help groups. These are the kinds of chit funds and these are regulated ones. Then we have advances against the supply or hiring of goods and advances against long-term projects for the supply of capital goods. So the main purpose here is to ban the deposits which are in the nature of Ponzi scheme. So it is noteworthy to understand here the difference between the deposits for business and business of accepting the deposits. So the deposits for business are not banned, whereas business of accepting deposits, which are a kind of Ponzi scheme, are banned. They are not banned, they are banned. Now moving on, who are highly impacted by this provision, by this act? So the deposits with the builders, the jewelers and other types of businesses that do not have regulatory approvals. So the ones which operates under the unregulatory mechanism, unregulatory system, they are the highly impacted ones, because you must have seen that through word of mouth, most real estate developers takes the loan against the promissory notes for the repayment after the tenures like 3, 6 or 12 months. So these kind of real estate developers or jewelers, maybe they are highly impacted, because now the proceedings could be there, and we'll understand that there can be two cases: the investors who have given the deposits before this ordinance and the investors who have given the deposits after this ordinance. So we'll discuss these two cases in the next section. Firstly, let's clear this thing that not all the deposit schemes offered by builders and jewelers have been banned, because I have already told you that deposits for business are not banned, but the business of accepting deposits is banned. So deposit schemes with builders and jewelers, like if they take the advances against the purchase of goods at a later date, have not been banned. For example, if a builder takes a credit from an investor against the specific immovable property to be transferred to the buyer, so this is not banned. So let's understand the basic purpose, basic aim, that it is banned for the unregulated deposits for the business engaged in loan money like Ponzi scheme to protect the small investors. But loan taken for a business activity is not considered under this act. That is, they are exempt. So if we understand this through an example, suppose if you pay 20 lakh as deposit to a builder and using this payment against a flat purchase. So you have to purchase a flat, and for this flat you are giving deposit of 20 lakh as advance. So this kind of transaction would not be prohibited. But in the other case, if you give 20 lakh to the same builder against the payment of interest but no asset to be acquired when the scheme ends, then that will be considered as unregulated deposit. And these kinds of transactions are mostly undertaken by jewelers and builders, and that is why they are highly impacted after this act. So we have already did this, that not apply, that this act does not apply to deposits taken in the ordinary course of business, Because the government doesn't want to hamper the ordinary course of business. They do not want that the business activity is stopped. Because every business requires loans to function. So the loans taken for business is not prohibited, but the business of accepting the loans and making it as a business, just like in Ponzi scheme, that is prohibited. So this point is really important to answer the question that I have just mentioned earlier. Now, what is the need to ban the unregulated deposit scheme 2019? So we all know that in India, many deposit takers, they do fraud, they commit fraud, and small investors who have invested their deposits with them, who have deposited, they suffer a lot. So to protect the gullible investors from being duped by Ponzi schemes, to tackle the menace of illicit deposit taking activities, which is illegal deposit taking activities in the country, which at present is exploiting the regulatory gaps. So to fill in those regulatory gaps, the ban on the unregulated deposit scheme has been initiated. Next is to make the practice of soliciting, inviting or accepting the deposits pursuant to an unregulated deposit scheme as a punishable offense. So anyone who commits this, who invites or accepts the deposits under the unregulated deposit scheme, that will be considered as an punishable offense, and various fines and imprisonment have been mentioned in this bill also, which I will be discussing. So this bill, which is Unregulated Deposit Schemes Bill 2019, that creates three types of offenses. So the first kind of offense is when you are running unregulated deposit schemes. So that will include if you advertise or you operate or you accept the money for such schemes. Second type of offense is the fraudulent default. So if someone, a deposit taker, suppose A, has taken the deposits from many people and he frauds. So this is the another type of offense. And the third kind of offense is the wrongful inducement. That is, if you prompt the investors, it is prompting investors to invest in these kind of schemes. So if you are wrongfully inducing them through falsifying the details, through falsifying the facts, then this is the third kind of offense under this bill. Now, who is guilty? So the investors who are investing are not guilty, but the deposit taker who is accepting the deposits from many investors, either through falsifying the information or through prompting them, he is the one who is guilty under this scheme. Then the next section that we'll be discussing is that what will happen with the investors and deposit taker if the money is lent before the ban. So if the investor has deposited before the date of ban, then what will happen to such an investor? So this bill says that such kind of deposits are not covered by this bill, this scheme, and such investors can have other legal remedies. So such legal remedies may be under the law, section 420 of IPC, wherein the entire deposit will be illegal whether or not that investor has received the interest or not. Then the other type of case is when an investor who is unaware of the ban have made the deposit after the enactment of the ordinance. So there is a proper mechanism mentioned in this ordinance. Firstly, there would be a competent authority in this regard. So who is a competent authority? So this bill says that there should be an appointment of one or more government officers, not below the rank of secretary, to the state or central government. So such person can be a competent authority. So competent authority has a key role to play here. He could either provisionally attach the property of the deposit taker as well as all deposits received. Second is he could either summon or he could examine any person for the purpose of obtaining the evidence. So when he provisionally attached the deposit and which also includes the property acquired by the deposit taker, that is known as provisional attachment. So then the competent authority shall move to the designated court, which should be in the same state, for making the provisional attachment as absolute. So this is important, that after the competent authority, the application should be passed on to the designated court, and then the designated court has 180 days to complete the proceedings from the date of receipt of the application from the competent authority. So the day he submits the application to the designated court, from that day onwards, 180 days period will start, and then within 180 days, the designated court has to complete the proceedings. Then the next provision mentioned here is online central database. So the bill also provides central government to designate an authority to create the online central database for information on the deposit taking activities and deposit takers. So the deposit takers will be required to inform the database authority about their business. So it is a duty of the deposit takers to inform the database authority about their business. So competent authority will be required to share all the information on unregulated deposits with the authority as well. Now there are several kind of punishments involved here. First is the first, it relates to the first offense that we have discussed, running unregulated deposit schemes. So the punishment is 2 to 7 years of imprisonment and a fine of rupees 3 lakh to 10 lakhs. This offense, this punishment relates to the second type of offense that we have studied, that fraudulent default in regulated deposit scheme. So it is from 3 to 10 years of imprisonment and a fine ranging from 5 lakh, which can also be doubled of the amount collected from the depositors. So if a depositor has collected 10 lakh rupees, so this line means that the punishment, that the fine could be from 5 lakh to 20 lakh, exact double of the amount which has been accepted by the deposit taker. The third one is repeat offenders, which is up to 10 years of imprisonment and a fine ranging from 10 lakhs to 5 crore rupees. So the punishments are there to protect the small investors, to ban the Ponzi schemes which are happening in India. So in tell me more, Lok Sabha in February has passed this bill, but it could not be passed by the Rajya Sabha. So since Parliament was not in session, banning has been issued by President, because according to the Article 123 of the Constitution, President have the power to promulgate ordinances during the recess of Parliament. So there is a difference between ordinance and act. So I would like to tell you that act is a law which is passed by the Parliament, but that is both the houses, Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, and it has the assent of the President also. Whereas ordinance is also a law, but without being subject to discussion and deliberation in both or one of the houses of the Parliament. So a president could pass the ordinance according to Article 123 during the recess of the Parliament. Now coming back to the question was that Parliament clears bill to ban unregulated deposits, which seeks to protect the interest of the depositors. Which of the following activity is not included or exempted in the ambit of this bill? So after the discussion which I have done with you guys, you will definitely be able to answer this question now. So first is the regulated chit funds. So as we know that regulated chit funds are exempt. This is exempt, and the question asks us to identify the activity which is not exempt. Now we have second is a builder taking loans against the promissory note for repayment after 10 years of 3, 6 or 12 months. So we have done this thing also, that the business of accepting deposits has been banned, so this is not exempted. So the correct answer is B, but let us look at the other options also. C part says deposit schemes with builders and jewelers that work like advances against purchase of goods on a later date. So any loan taken during the ordinary course of business is exempt. So a loan taken by a person from his friends or relatives is also exempt. So the only activity which is not exempted is a builder taking loans against promissory note for repayment after 10 years of 3, 6 or 12 months, and the correct answer therefore is option number B. I hope you guys like my video and find this video an informational one. Do subscribe to our channel for more financial current affairs. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you.